In my big dream imagining, we get to distill the deepest stories and the truths that come out of community and out of history. When we have our voices heard and have our messages heard, we become leaders.
Yitzap Oweli al Siaya Siam Si Alakwa Ich Imakne Eten Antha Jada-Gabrielle Pape Antha Wu Wasselwat. Welcome to the Drawing Wisdom video podcast. We're in season 3. This is episode 6, where our whole Drawing Wisdom team of Kat Dodds, David Ng, and myself, Jada-Gabrielle Pape, come together as co-conspirators in conversation. Here we are, doing our final episode of the Drawing Wisdom video podcast for season 3. And nice to be in conversation with you both. Part of what feels really important is that we're always looking for ways to enact truth and reconciliation, mm-hmm. right? That's part of the landscape we live in now. Mm-hmm. And so that means, like for me as an Indigenous person, that means I can't live in a bubble and just be with my own people. Mm-hmm. That's not how the world works. Mm-hmm. So in overlapping projects, it means coming into relationships with, being in solidarity mm-hmm. with non-Indigenous people. Mm-hmm. And that is surprisingly difficult mm-hmm. and challenging. And I think part of the work that we do is, it is enacting truth and reconciliation. We bring up hard truths in stories we cover, yeah. mm-hmm. and we focus on the strengths of those stories. Yeah. Mm-hmm. We celebrate it and uphold it. And then I think also part of, you know, creating Drawing Wisdom has given us a platform. Mm-hmm. And I guess maybe we want to identify, because we talk about Drawing Wisdom like we all know what it is.
Well, it's kind of our operating principle. You know, trying to define it was hard at first. Like, is it an initiative? Is it a company? Is it a production company? Right. Is it what? And so we started by saying we did a bunch of different things, which we do. But really, it's a philosophy.
Right.
And a platform
now. And also a podcast.
Yes. Right.
And also a production company at times.
Yeah.
And et cetera.
And I guess, you know, part of it is that, like, when you say that we had a hard time defining it in the beginning, I think it's fair to say I didn't know what we were doing a great deal of the time, because my skill set is, like, I hone in on the story and follow the pattern, and your skill set is to see something really, really big. And I'm often like, I don't really know what you're seeing, because I'm not seeing it yet. But then once I wait, like I don't have to wait a long time, I'm like, oh, that's what we're doing. And it's so clear. Mm. But we actually bring very different things. Mm-hmm. And I feel like that's part of that model mm-hmm. of just paying attention, trusting the process.
Yeah.
Listening to each other. And, yep. and trusting each other, and then yep. building, then I think the people that are not in our internal team that participate in that, they come to trust us because they see yep. it happening.
Yep. Yep.
And then that trust is reinforced by the outcome of the project, which yep. always shows them that they've been listened to.
Yeah.
Like, yep. projects are different, but I think the common thing is that it, maybe it isn't articulated this, but I think the communities that we make projects for, when they see them, I think they definitely feel seen and heard
yeah.
from what comes out of it.
And I don't know, does that, if someone were to say, what is this Drawing Wisdom? I don't even know if we've even answered it there.
No.
Drawing Wisdom is a platform, it's a philosophy, it is a collective of artists and supporters who pay very close attention to be in service mm-hmm. of the stories of Indigenous peoples and communities. Mm-hmm. Is that?
Yeah. That's good.
That's good. That's good. Now we use that.
Now we know what it is.
Yeah. We solved that one.
Well, yeah. That's what we're doing.
That's what we're doing. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah.
Good. But the podcast came up during the pandemic.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it started all virtual with our conversations that we were having anyway.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, they started actually with cocktail hours.
Yeah.
Virtual cocktail hours
because we were tired of being by ourselves and not talking.
Yeah. The work that we've been able to do together to sort of also balance each other and hear each other and do work together. Like, I mean, that's like 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
You know, of
consistent.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Like. Trust building and like I'm thinking and then I'm coming to like when we had those cocktail hours, like we got into some like really
deep and
sticky
stuff.
Mm-hmm. But it being able to, you know, sit and say, you know, well, that's, you know, not, that's not my lived experience.
Mm-hmm.
And to be able to really talk through the grittiness of like colonialism and then we thought
maybe this is a conversation
that we should share.
Yeah, exactly.
I think those are really hard conversations when people engage in what my dad used to call the I'm right game.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And so the I'm right game is everybody goes in wanting everyone else to know, goes into a conversation wanting everyone else to know the ways that they are experts and that they have their truth and that is the truth. Mm-hmm. And actually, if we go in quite differently and this is the how can I be changed? And I think that's something that the three of us were able to navigate and then recognize there is some importance in hearing the different experiences.
Yeah.
There's something to be learned from it.
Yeah.
Well, it's what Jenna was talking about in the podcast interview recently about hard truths without compassion are, in fact, acts of violence or create injustices. And they're harmful.
Yeah, which is kind of the same thing I think about the sort of big push all the time for innovation.
Mm-hmm.
Like innovation without accountability to grassroots, to communities, to people is the same as colonization. It's like forcing... Yeah.
Destructive.
Yeah, it becomes destructive, whereas innovation that's in service and accountable is another whole matter altogether.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And so much of the... like, well, even the way people converse, and I'm guilty of this too, when I'm put in this kind of situation, conversations can become so combative right away.
Yeah.
Amongst people. Like there seems to be a drive towards that kind of being challenged, and then you have to defend yourself.
Yeah.
And that's so different than a conversation that's about trust building, like, or even just inquiry, like just wanting to hear.
Well, it's also what's also coming up for me is there's an interesting, there was a difference between when we were having a private conversation.
Yes. Yes.
And now that there's a camera where
we're not swearing as much.
We're not swearing as much, but also like where who's being extracted from because there's a camera.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And that's been a bit of a negotiation or a thing that we've had to sit with or figure out.
Mm-hmm.
Because that does change a bit.
Yeah, and you know, like from I don't think I really understood when we dove into the podcast. It wasn't until we were in the middle of recording it that I became cognizant of, oh, I actually have to be very careful because I'm not going to be in the room when people listen to it. I don't know who's going to listen to it.
Yeah.
And I can't trust that people are going to be listening to this and nodding their heads.
Right. Yeah.
And I can't trust that I'm talking to, whether it's my people as Indigenous people or my community.
Yeah.
And so... There is a self-censoring that that has occurred, you know, that I'm consistently mindful of, and also that I'm resentful of that, that we can't predict this, and that the world is unsafe to have clear expression.
Yeah.
And it also strikes me that we're all doing a version of that, like the second we wake up and leave the house. This puts a highlight on that.
Yeah, and we're doing a version of that too when we're making films about other people with them too, because often when you do get that trust, there may be things said that are too much to be put out into the public.
Yes.
And we're very careful about that.
Yeah.
And I mean, that's so completely antithetical to quote-unquote reality TV, which is produced and scripted to build on those conflicts, poke that conflict until it erupts, and document it and make that the drama.
Yeah.
So, literally, the starring your own stories and our drawing wisdom process is the absolute opposite of that.
Yeah.
It's about making it safe for people to say what they really think and then having the responsibility to be careful what we also put out later.
There's a recent story. I did a project where there was an elder who is from a different generation and also didn't speak a lot of English. And when we interviewed them, because it was a project where they were receiving services, and they kept the entire interview thanking the government of Canada. Because they thought I know this is an extreme example, but they thought that that's what they had to do. Right. Is they're being filmed and they should be thankful to the government of Canada. And so we had to be careful about how to craft that story so that it wasn't. Mm-hmm. But I guess where I'm getting that is that when Jada, when you're talking about like waking up and having to perform, like this is an extreme example of like this vulnerable person felt that they had to thank the government on camera. And that's sort of an underlayer of sort of, I guess you could say, systemic exploitation that we had to be careful about how we told that story.
Well, it's one of the narratives, right? It's one of the newcomer narratives that, I mean, I'm not even sure how it is so ingrained into newcomer experiences to know a very crafted perspective of Canada, a very crafted anti-Indigenous sentiment it's totally common.
Yeah.
And I know that there are books that people get, or not books, but manuals that people get that completely eliminate the Indigenous people's truths.
Yeah.
But part of what you're describing there is it is a reality.
Mm-hmm.
It's important to pay attention to it. And if we understand the larger picture, we'll make sure that we don't put that into the story because it's not helpful to the story and it's not helpful to that person.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe it's not helpful to the ripple effect of how their family will view the content that we're creating.
Yeah.
And I think it's not like a paternalistic protecting people, but it is recognizing when people sign up, they may not have all of those insights. And so our job is sometimes to slow it down and give it back to them.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And you know, like one of the key things that we do that feels so important that it is a departure is we always, you know, when we have people sign release forms and consent forms, it's actually to protect them. It's not to protect us. And that we very specifically are saying, here's a thing, we want you to sign it to make sure that we are held responsible for the footage that we don't turn it around and use it for our own benefit later and without your consent, and that you will have final approval. And when we give people back the transcripts of their interviews, we ask them, like, first of all, we take out all the ums, ahs, like all the filler that people have, because they don't need to see themselves reflected that way. And then we ask them, is there anything in here you do not want us to use?
Yeah.
And we never ask questions about why. We never push them.
Yeah.
It is not shame-based. Yeah. There is no regret. It's just very simple. And that's something, when I talk to other people, that's a big extra step.
Mm-hmm.
And it's the first step.
Yeah.
It just makes perfect sense.
Yeah.
And I've heard people say that's a lot of extra work for your team.
Mm-hmm.
I can't imagine doing it any other way
and
causing injury through not doing that.
Yeah,
you're
exactly.
You're literally editing, okay, I mean, I do video edit, right? But so you're literally editing people's words that are coming out of their mouths.
Yeah.
Well, when it comes to broadcast, all of those release forms and errors and emissions insurance that you have to buy, it's all because they're worried about there being some injunction slapped on them, and it's their content, and it's their business, and like the, you know, and so that's the reason for it. So it's not about protecting the person interviewed.
No.
And I think part of why we all get a little bit puffed up and just agitated is because on the ground when we start to talk to people and hear the stories of where this has real impact in people's day-to-day lives, I think that's where we bring it back to the intimacy of like somebody's telling you about, you know, I had a story, no one listened, I've been saying this for 20 years. And maybe that isn't an individual story, maybe it's a community's story. And then now it's in, so an example is, you know, in when the first 215 of the children's bodies started to be recognized by mainstream media. Those were stories that in my communities we'd been talking about forever. That anytime somebody had the wherewithal or the courage to raise or surface a story about their experience in residential school, they always told stories about the murdered children and the bodies. Always. They never left it out. But there was nothing being talked about until a few years ago in mainstream media. And so somehow Canada was like, oh, this is real. And so that's that thing about if we're not paying attention, a huge amount of people are being ignored. And those are the stories that, like, those are the people that I'm enraged for. Mm-hmm. I'm not really enraged about, like, the imbalance of power is what I really struggle with it. And I really struggle with how do we opt out from those structures, mm-hmm. and those frameworks in dominant culture to do good work. Yeah. And we still have to jump through hoops. So I was just thinking about our season 3 of the podcast, and I have a chuckle every once in a while when I think about how we were doing in season 1, and the moment of tension between each of us bringing our own skills to the podcast and David's wonderful gift of keeping things very organized and streamlined and my wonderful gift of just make a mess of everything and don't ever have a schedule or an agenda. And how David, at one point you said, I feel like we should get more participants lined up like now rather than later. And I was like, oh, we could do that, sure. And so this season we had far more participants than in previous seasons ready to go, lined up, scheduled. Mm-hmm. And there was a real ease with it, like mm-hmm. sort of not coming into our own, but it became a more streamlined process, which allowed for some flexibility with content, that like richer conversations. I wonder what was a highlight from this season for either of you?
Well, the conversation with Jenna, when you guys really got into sort of some of the delicate and sticky conversations around trauma-informed, quote-unquote,
mm-hmm.
and telling truth and doing it with compassion, but also sort of like just being thoughtful or mindful, I think, of when to speak truth, because sometimes the person receiving it may not be in a place to hear it. Mm. And I was sharing before we started shooting, you know, that's been something that I've really been grappling with as well, because in some of the circles that I've been in where people are going through a tough time and might be, speaking the truth might actually be not the right time, or mm-hmm. at that time actually might be harmful mm-hmm. to the person because whatever they're going through. And that's been very hard for me because I resonated with Jenna, like I can be a very sharp shooter and I believe in speaking it and laying things on the table when they need to be. And sometimes that, I think it's that conversation really stuck out to me about the trauma-informed, doing things with care, but also being reflexive or thinking about how you are doing that.
Yeah, what I hear in that is that listening to Jenna speak with the humility that she speaks with and with the caring nature that she has allowed you the safety to reflect on your own process and ways of being, which is, I think, for me, it's one of the gifts of being in these conversations, is people generously share, and if we're open to it, we become transformed. Mm-hmm. What about for you? What was a highlight?
I really enjoyed the conversation with Michelle. And it was just, I found it so interesting. And I had not read her book before the interview, but I finished it before I actually edited the episodes. And it was really wonderful. Like, the book is amazing. It was just really rich, though, reading the book after having heard her talking about the process with you and just talking about her ideas and all of those things. And just the way she is able to weave such hard things into such gentle stories that make you, like, it's what everyone wants to do, but it's hardly hard to know how to do it, mm-hmm. creating that sort of deep empathy that she does. And I found her in the interviews with her, that was coming out with me too. Like, she really has a way, I guess it's the storyteller, like she really has this storytelling gift mm-hmm. that makes the hard things, I wouldn't say easier to hear because it's not that, but I feel more compassionate just by being in her presence, whether it's the book or the podcast. Mm-hmm. And it's really, I don't know if she has that effect on everyone, but that's certainly the effect it had on me.
I would venture to say nobody has that effect on anyone or on everyone all the yeah. time. And I think part of what your experience of that is, where it overlaps with my experience of that, like what really resonates for me is that Michelle has a real vulnerability that she puts in the foreground, allows her own story and her own people's story to be known, and also has done great reflection around it. So mm-hmm. she doesn't bleed out in the conversation. She's done her work around it, but there's real vulnerability and and she's another good example, much like Jenna, of speaking truth, but with compassion. Mm-hmm. And it's part of the nature of courageous conversations, is we need to mm-hmm. speak what is true.
Yeah, and yeah. I mean, her book is a fiction, but it's a fiction based on truths. Yeah. And then it was reinforced again when I was speaking to some of the people we interviewed for a different project. And also listening to those interviews, and just like some of the things she had described in her characters happening as fiction, I heard them describing as fact. Mm-hmm. All while worth noting, because it isn't obvious to the people watching this, but her book is set in the exact location we are in right now, in this neighborhood of the Downtown East Side yeah. and Gastown and this whole area. And that also made it poignant to me, because mm-hmm. I've been living in this area for a long time, and we've been collectively working in this area off and on the entire time mm-hmm. we've been working together, and so it was really, really sort of the poetry of the feeling of the location was there too.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think like you're describing is the poetry of the location makes really good sense, because for me this neighborhood is completely infused with love stories.
Yeah. Yeah.
And they're the love stories of people caring for each other and caring mm-hmm. for caring for their stories. And I feel like this neighborhood of the Downtown East Side gets painted as a wasteland mm-hmm. or as a problem. And in actuality, the incredible grace that is here when we sit and listen to it, is transformational.
It's transformational. Yeah, I would say that.
Yeah.
And it's also one of the reasons I don't feel like leaving this part mm-hmm. of the town, even though I know it has its difficulties.
Mm-hmm. I think every neighborhood is going to have its mm-hmm. its challenges, yeah. and this yeah. one just doesn't have any pretense around it.
Yeah, yeah. exactly.
Yeah.
It's not
there's
hidden.
No filter.
Yeah.
It's an unfiltered neighborhood.
Yeah, totally, yeah. totally.
Yeah.
And yeah, and I think this neighborhood is, in part, we could describe it as it's a neighborhood filled with warriors, that mm. they are the people who are who have experienced such pain and wake up and continue to to be on the front lines and live their lives in the front lines.
Including the other guests that we interviewed in this season's podcast.
Yes. And they hold really, really important stories. Yeah, I love that we get to do the podcast and have these conversations. Yeah, I love it.
Well, and I like the format too, because it's not necessarily an interview.
No.
You know?
No.
I like the conversation format.
Yeah. I think that's actually what skilled interviews should be, is conversations, that people should leave feeling better than when they came in. People should feel cared for. I'm thinking about, we all came together to bear witness to other people's stories, and every once in a while we venture into this artistic terrain of sharing our own stories, which sometimes I think it's so cool, like all these overlaps that we have and ways we get to work together. And then I think, who cares about us? I mean, certainly who cares about me? And then I also think, I wonder, like when we're thinking about where we are, where we intersect in our work and in our philosophies, and then that we're all doing very different work in the world, but it's exactly the same work.
And I would say, in the, on this theme of art, and I'm thinking about themes of like care and accountability, it's that care that and attention to detail, you know, you want to say that in the art, like, you know, world or whatever, but it's also that attention to detail in community, the community work that we do, in the process that we do, it's being an artist. But thinking about it not just as a, as the object, per se.
Yeah, that it belongs
to... The process is our medium.
And the process is emergent. It's sort of building on itself. And so we'll, let's see what happens here.
Let's see what emerges from this.
So this concludes season 3 of the Drawing Wisdom video podcast. Check us out on drawingwisdom.ca, where you can have links to our social media, as well as see notes about all of the episodes, and tune in to more episodes. Take good, gentle care.